Hi, pals. I'm Dominic, and this is DC Talks for the week of April 1st, 2019. Hey, pals. I know I've been gone for a few months now, actually, and I was just real fast on that. I was testing to see how I could do it daily, see how I fit into my workflow. I can definitely do it now. It did not fit when I was recording my previous podcast for the Miami Vice podcast. That show is now done, so now I'm back to doing this every day. I know that doesn't mean much of a promise because I said I was going to do it every day and then I disappeared for a long time. I'm here to do daily for the foreseeable future. Enough about me and this podcast. I want to get into what it is I'm going to be talking about this week. Because even though I've been gone, the tech news continues to roll. And last week had a ton of news to talk about. Of course, Apple had a keynote on Monday. There was a ton of gaming news that came out. So there's a whole bunch of stuff to get into. And I'm looking forward to talking about all of those things and just kind of where I stand. And then with the lens going through the open source and real world kind of tech perspective on things. And not just how many $10 a month services can I sign up for? How many $10 bills can I pay out to fix all my tech problems? Kind of how can you do it yourself? How can you build some things of your own? How can you save some money and actually support some really good software that's out there, really good hardware that's out there, and not an emphasis on always buying something brand new and not feeling like the solution to whatever tech challenge that I'm running into is to just drop $300-$500 on a new tablet or $1,000 on a new computer or $1,200 on a new phone. Hey, what exists? What can I use? What is it that's happening in the real world? How do I get my job done? How do I talk to my family? How do I have some fun? And so that's what this podcast is really all about, looking at the news and then looking at the real world perspective in that news. And it's not always the top of the headline. And this time, what I really want to start off with is something that Brian Acton, the co-founder of WhatsApp, had said last week. And he has said it a few times. And so this is the first thing that I want to talk about this week. He has said it a few times that to delete Facebook. And he's the co-founder of WhatsApp. So he is obviously a little invested into the Facebook community or the company itself. It's a little invested. Now, he's not with Facebook anymore. He left last year, or it might have been 2017 when he left that company. He left for good out of Facebook. He took his money and he went to go do some other things, including invest into the Signal protocol for the Signal chat app, which is the encryption that WhatsApp also uses. And Mark Zuckerberg has kind of floated out there that encryption is going to be key in how they integrate all of the chat apps in the Facebook world into a single unified chat experience. Now, I think that means that everyone's chat will still exist on their own apps. Like Instagram will still be there, Facebook Messenger will still be there, but it makes it easy to go chats across platforms. At least that's what I believe Mark Zuckerberg has said. WhatsApp is going to fit into that, and so everyone's been kind of waiting to see what's going to happen with that Zuckerberg statement. Brian Acton has been going out and saying, delete Facebook. They're not to be trusted. You should just delete the app. And so what I saw that when he said it again this week, it got me thinking more about my usage of WhatsApp and kind of actually how I'm going to change how I'm going to talk about things here on this podcast. Because on Thursdays, I want to talk about weekend projects. What can we do this weekend? What can I do this weekend to do something cool? Try something new. Set up some new server. Set up a new service. Try out a new app. Do something new with gaming. I don't know. Just do something cool with technology because there's so much cool stuff that's out there. And this time that Brian Acton was talking about to delete Facebook got me thinking about my own WhatsApp usage and how I can kind of decentralize from Facebook. I'm already not an avid Facebook user. I don't have it on my phone. I don't have it like in a browser tab that's always open on my computer. I just kind of pulse check it every once in a while. And that's not because I've had some big grandstand against Facebook. It's just because I just don't use it. It's just not something that I use that often. It's a tool that I communicate with a few people on, but it's not like it's a key crucial part of my outreach to my friends and family. Twitter, on the other hand, is a big piece of that. But the biggest thing is chat, and chat is incredibly personal. And when I'm thinking about Hey, so what should I do about WhatsApp and what should I do about chat when it comes to family? Me and my wife, we chat all day long. There's always a chat thread that is going on. And then I'm also a father of two teenagers, and so that means that lots of chats are flying. And they're not just sharing memes or talking about the news or sharing a link. Some of that stuff does happen, but most of the time, those chats are extremely personal. Family issues, finance, shopping lists, sharing passwords, all those things are incredibly personal. And having a trust in the chat application that you use to be able to send that kind of information across every day is nagging at me more and more and more. Like, this needs to be taken way more seriously and being put into the hands of something that's much more trustworthy than Facebook. I know that WhatsApp's protocol and how they're treated as a separate company isn't so much of a concern, but just got me thinking about, man, I have all these really important chats that I do, and I have all of these really personal things. And me and my wife have changed chat apps a bunch of times over the last 5 years. And we're on a shared ecosystem, one Android, one iOS, because I have an iPhone for work. And my wife uses an Android, and so like using iMessage isn't really a thing, and SMS or carriers. I mean, yeah, of all people to really trust, the carriers are the ones that we should put all of our trust in, right? AT&T and Verizon and T-Mobile, they have no vested interest in prying into people's text messages, right? So they thinking about all of that, like, you know what would be a cool weekend project is to set up my own chat server. And it's something I have done before with varying success as I've grown as a weekend sysadmin. I've gotten better at being able to stand up servers and be able to configure them and be able to safely configure those kinds of things. And still not the best, but that's also the best in considering like setting up a server that is you're going to be used for hundreds, thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people. In this case, talking about two people. Five people that are going to be using it. And chat seems like one of the easier things to get set up and going. When I was looking at the list of things that there could potentially be for a weekend project to set up something like, hey, let's give it a try. Let's see if it works. If it works well for us, then we'll stick with it. If it doesn't, then, there's lots of chat apps that are out there. WhatsApp is still working for now. We'll see where Facebook takes it. So it's just a fun weekend project that I'm going to do. And when I was going through the list of potential chat apps that could be used, there's obviously lots of self-hosted chat apps that you can use. There's Riot, there's Mattermost, there's a plethora of Slack-like services that you can set up, and that's kind of what Mattermost is. And then, to be honest with you, it's kind of what Riot looks like too. Looks a lot like Slack. But what I was looking for in my list of requirements that I needed was a simple chat. No frills, don't need to do big group video calls or anything like that. Just I need to be able to send words from my device to another device, and that person needs to be able to send words back, and I need to be able to read them, and they need to be in a timely manner. It also needs to be multi-device support. As I mentioned, I'm iOS, my wife is Android. I also use two different computers. My office is all Apple. And then my home is all Linux. So the desktop apps, I would like it to be diversified so I can use it across multiple different apps. For me, who sits at a desk all the time, I like to be able to do those kinds of things from my desktop, not have to have my phone out all the time to be able to reply to text messages. Like I mentioned, me and wife are messaging each other all day long. I get to do it from my laptop as I'm also doing other work throughout the day. I can imagine my wife with also two young children who hearing her phone going ding, 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 knowing that I'm a messenger type where each sentence is its own send. So 15 messages later to say basically one thing, probably kind of annoying. So as I was going through these requirements, once I got to what I needed, it became pretty clear that what I was looking for was just an XMPP server. Or what was called back in the day, Jabber. And XMPP has been around since 1999, and it really hit its heyday in, like the mid-aughts, mid to late aughts is when it hit its heyday. And it was supported by Google Talk and by even by Facebook for a period of time. There was some Skype integration for a while. All of those things kind of came to a stop in 2014. Now, that's not to say that XMPP or Jabber or whatever you want to call it went away. It just meant that the major players stopped supporting XMPP. And that's really because chat as a service became big business. 2014 is the time when tech press really started to cover chat as being the new social media. That was the new growth realm. That was the place where marketing needed to get into. My day job as a marketer, we looked at how do we get involved into chat? How do we offer chat-like services? How do we have a WhatsApp that people can send messages to for customer support? Those kinds of things. So 2014 was about when those things started to come up. And so the dream of like what we had in the late 90s and early 2000s through instant message, which was single application, multiple chat services or instant message services, that was the dream. You can be on Yahoo or you could be on AIM and you could use a single instant message app and you could communicate with all of them. And Jabber was going to try and do the same thing. You can have multiple servers, a single application that can communicate across all of those servers. The problem is that the chat as a service became so popular that they decided to, everyone like Google, decided to silo their information into standalone applications. Growth in apps like WhatsApp becoming so immensely popular that they decided to silo all of their information away and then be forced into their walled garden. Move away from these open protocols to closed protocols. However, Jabber still exists. You can set up your own Jabber servers. They are insanely easy to set up. Now, there's a lot more steps when it comes to securing said server. But that's always the case when it comes to setting up your own self-hosted systems. Running a few commands for your Linux server, easy. Setting up all this proper security to be able to protect yourself, that takes some more know-how, some more steps to go through. Not saying that's impossible, just something to pay attention to. Just running sudo apt install prosody, which is the chat XMPP server that I decided to run, just by installing that doesn't mean that it's automatically just ready to go. There's additional configurations, there's server configurations that you need to do, and that's something that you need to take a active role in. So something to remember in when you're running your own self-hosted services is that you are now the system administrator. You are the one that needs to make sure that all that stuff is getting done. Chat as a service or anything as a service, cloud as a service, whatever it is, they're the ones that are taking care of that for you. So there is a value in letting someone else do it. For me, I looked at it as this is a weekend project. I can tackle this. Let's see how it works. Install prosody, set it up on a VPS. I have a dedicated VPS just for doing these kinds of things. It's worth the $5 a month just to get a domain and be able to set up multi-servers and run things in LixD or in Docker and then just configure it and let it run and see how it works. There's only two people using it. How much load this? I'm not going to use all the throughput that they give me in that anyway. So I set it up. It took an hour of doing everything, including the Let's Encrypt SSL certificate. So now the chats are being sent over SSL. After the configuration, give me a chance to run Wireshark for a while and do some capture of packets and see how the messages are coming through. That was a lot of fun too. So this was a great weekend project. And then we used it throughout the week and it worked phenomenal. It worked everywhere. I had a couple hiccups here and there. The biggest thing was transferring from my laptop to my phone. The messages were only in one place. I didn't see like the history of the chats on my phone. And or if I chatted on my phone, didn't see them on my desktop. But I'm also not convinced that I can't have some type of configuration that will help fix that problem. But for the most part, I didn't have any problems. It's set up really easy. We haven't had any chat problems. The messages have been going through just fine. And it's worked really well. So if you're looking for a weekend project, this would be something that I would recommend doing. You can set it up on your LAN too, so that when you log in, you just log in with your name at, and then the IP address, and then just lock it behind your LAN. If you want to give it a try, set up a Linux server on a virtual machine and then just give it a try. But this worked really well. And I think we're going to use it for a while to see how if it continues to work. So I'd love to hear from you and what you think about setting up your own chat. If you think that it's worth it, One of the things that I'm keeping my eye on is chat over IMAP, which would be really interesting, which would be very similar to XMPP, where it's like you can run your own server or there's central servers that you can piggyback off of. But then using email as a chat, because it is an open protocol, it's distributed everywhere. You can set up your own server and it's federated, so servers have to be able to communicate with each other. I'm following that project really closely. So if you want to see the links for that, you want to see the links for the server that I set up, all the software that goes along with it, you can check the links in the show notes and you'll be able to see all of that stuff. And like I said, I'd love to hear from you and what you think about running your own chat server, if you think that it's worth it, if you think that one of the problems with setting up your own chat server or anything chat related, not even your own server, but just switching to a different chat app, is getting friends and family to follow you onto that. XMPP feels very much like Discord, where you can do chat, you join a server, you have a chat, which is very similar to IRC. It's not public like that, so when you join a room, you just don't see everyone's chats that are happening. But IRC is also an open protocol, and you can totally host your own IRC servers. So, like I said, this was a cool project. I'd love to hear what your thoughts are on this, if you'd run something, if you think it's worth it, and if you think you'd get any traction from your friends and family, let me know. I'd love to hear that. All right, pals, the next thing I want to talk about this week is that Apple announcement. And I know it's been covered to death and being more than a week later. I don't think you count on me as being the top breaking news podcaster. I'm not in journalism where I'm going to be breaking. This is late breaking news on the Apple announcement that happened more than 7 days ago. I don't think that's where I'm going with this. Where I want to talk about this was News Plus in particular. Now, they did announce a whole bunch of other stuff. It's been covered all over the place. One of the things that I'm following really closely, as I've talked about with budget things, that I'm just a sucker for budget blogs. I can't stop myself from reading. If you say, learn how to save money or 10 ways to cut your budget or something along those lines, I'm going to read your blog. I cannot help myself. I will read every single one of them, even all of the dumb ones that say your path to financial freedom is to stop ordering drinks when you go out to eat and cut Starbucks out, and you can retire early because you'll have so much extra money, which is amazing financial advice for people who already have exorbitant amount of excess income that they just blow on dumb shit, instead of people who are like really looking for real budget advice, who do not go to Starbucks every single day, who do not go out to eat, who shop at the low budget stores, who buy all their clothes used. I'm getting off on a far off tangent here, which is not where I wanted to go with this take on Apple. Just, you know, finance. And finance has got me over the last week reading a lot about the credit card that Apple announced. And so just real fast before I get back in the News Plus, this is a kind of so-so credit card, to be totally honest with you. I know no fees, and they're going to be able to tell you what the name of the store is that you actually spent your money at, instead of the weird merchant ID that comes through when you run your credit card. That's cool, I guess. Lots of other places already do that. The returns that you get on the card, 1% for all purchases with the physical card, 2% when you pay with Apple Pay, and then 3% on Apple products. Like, that's not great for cashback. It's okay, I guess. And it depends on how much stuff you buy from Apple. The 3% is cool, but, and you're not going to spend a lot of money using Apple Pay, because there's not like a whole bunch of places that take that. So you're probably going to be running your card most of the time. And actually, I've only been able to successfully use Apple Pay one time. And even the clerk behind the counter was surprised that it worked. And it's not because Apple Pay doesn't work. It's because these terminals that are at all of these stores are pieces crap, and they hardly ever work. And so, and that's the feedback that I've gotten every time when I've used them at one of the stores, is that they're like, oh my god, it worked. Every time someone tries to use it, it fails miserably. So 2% when you use Apple Pay, probably not going to be money that you get back a whole bunch of times. So 1% when you use your credit card, cool, I guess. 1%, there's lots of cards that give you a lot better than that, and this is all if you qualify. Remember, in that announcement, they didn't say they're going to make qualification easier. They didn't say your interest rate was going to be lower. They just said things like no overdraft fees and no late fees, and then you get some cash back, especially when you buy Apple stuff. You're probably still going to get, and as far as I know, in the terms, somewhere between 13.95% and 23.95%, which is pretty standard for a crappy credit card. So the thing that I really want to talk about is News Plus, or Apple News, or whatever the fuck they're calling it. I don't know. They got dumb names, and Apple isn't alone in this. Every major tech company names our stuff terribly. Allo. Allo, Google, for a video chat application? News Plus and TV Plus for your new services, Apple? What? Anyways, news. Pay us for news. Where I've been looking at this hasn't necessarily been, can I afford $10 to be able to get these magazines? Because it's really heavy on the magazines. Not so much about news. Lots of rumors about how they weren't able to get big news players to sign up right away. Whatever. $10 a month for magazines. This is what you get in there. Well, my concern is, in this, is the worst type of exclusives is when it's a dual exclusive, which is when it requires it to be on a certain service and then also specific hardware. And this directly falls into the problem with News Plus that I can see into the future, not seeing that they've announced anything like this, but I can see in the future where it'd be weird if this happened, because we see it in other places. Games is a great example of this. There is an exclusive for a PlayStation or Xbox. Obviously, almost all Nintendo games or games from Nintendo or exclusives to Nintendo hardware. But there's games exclusives. They only work on that hardware. You need both the game, buy the game, and then you need to also have the hardware. So you need to invest in that hardware in order to be able to play it. Unlike PC games, where you can have any PC that you want. Even Epic making some waves with Steam and then also with GOG and all kinds of other stores that have opened up on the PC. Not so much a problem because you can just download and install the store on your PC unless you're gaming on Linux, and that's me. So the problem is that you have to have the pay for the service, which is exclusive to that hardware. So in order for me to get this thing, I need to subscribe to your service. Your service is the only one that can get it. Netflix obviously does this. They're like half of where I have a problem here. Half of it is you have to subscribe to Netflix in order to watch Stranger Things. But it would be worse if you could only watch it then on Roku devices, not on any other device. You could only watch on Roku. So that means you have to subscribe to the, in order to watch the show, you have to subscribe to the service and also have a specific set of hardware. That is a major problem. And Apple is working really hard to make sure that this happens. Apple Arcade, the game service that they didn't announce a price for, this News Plus was the only thing that they actually announced a price for. Everything else is, who knows? We'll wait for other people to set prices, then we'll gauge off of that. The $10 a month for News Plus, though, was the only thing that they announced. And Arcade, they didn't announce a price, but they said they're exclusive games to the iPhone or to the Apple ecosystem. Not iPhone, sorry, because they're saying the games are going to be able for iPad and for Mac, and that's cool for the gaming platform of OS X. You can get some mobile games. Yay! The problem is that you have to have that specific hardware, and gaming's been doing that for a while. There's video starting to come up into that. Every kind of service has their own exclusives. Apple announced their own exclusives, too. But they also announced it's going to be on multiple sets of hardware, so it's kind of okay, right? If the Apple TV and TV Plus come to Roku and Fire TV and then later to other popular streaming devices, probably not the Chromecast. If it comes to those other places, then it's okay. You still have to subscribe to the service to be able to get it, but you can have whatever hardware that you want. And then on top of that, in a lot of cases, you can buy DVDs or Blu-rays after the fact. So if you don't want to subscribe to the streaming service, the show is for sale later on Blu-ray, or maybe you can just buy it outright from Amazon or Vudu or wherever. You can just buy a physical copy. Not a physical, obviously Vudu or whatever. You know what I mean. So they're like halfway there, but we're trending towards that this would be a common thing. We have to invest in specific hardware too, because the content creators and the platforms are trying to monetize everything that they can. As I said, my day job is a marketer, so I look at these opportunities like, oh, how can we increase our market share on this? Well, or how do we increase our financial investment. And one of the ways you do that is you say, well, we make partnerships. We have a partnership to be able to make this show exclusive on our service. That means it increases our subscribers. We advertise the crap out of it to get you to subscribe to our service, CBS All Access, Star Trek. Then you say, well, in order for us to monetize this even more, what if we only partner with specific hardware providers? And then they win in this because they can advertise, watch Star Trek, whatever it is. I'm just making things up. This is the way that it is. Watch it exclusively on this hardware. We sell more hardware units. They get more people to watch the show. Me, as the content platform that has created this, not necessarily the directors or the actors, but me who has created this, the producer, gets more money because I've been able to monetize it in multiple ways. That's a problem because then you have to be invested in that specific hardware. Where I would draw the line is news, and it's not where Apple has actually announced this, but if there is in the future, we are trending towards a future where news is locked behind a specific service. It is locked behind a double layer of protection. That way, it's only available to specific sets of people. And that's where I really draw the line, is that news needs to be open. It needs to be free. It needs to be eligible for everyone. And the platforms that are going to encourage this are so big, like Apple and Google and Amazon, Microsoft, they're so big that they could probably convince these publishers to do something like that, because in a lot of cases, they're also really desperate for money. These publishers are really struggling to be able to monetize their content, and they're looking for every opportunity that they can. And if Apple's willing to back a dump truck of money up to the New York Times and say, make your paid content exclusively available on News Plus, that is an enticing offer to that publisher, but not the best for people who really need good news. And not that any of this has actually happened, but it's just the conspiracy theorist in me, because we can see it happening in other types of content, in games, in video, in music, and in some degree, those things. Not, there isn't a lot of examples of like where it's hardware and software subscription specific, but they're growing, and it's a trend that I don't like. And I'd love to hear from you and see what you think about this trend. And if you're okay with that, is it okay if a specific news source is only making it available to a specific subscription service and also is only available on a specific type of hardware? Is that okay with you? I'd love to hear from you. Tweet at me at Dom Corvo, or get the notes below the show and let me know. And I'd love to see what you think about that, and let me know if it is a problem, what's the solution to that? And if it's not a problem, then why? I can guess it's not a problem because you do have access to it. You just choose not to. But a $1,000 iPhone XR, or you know, $700 and something XR plus $10 a month for news would be quite the hurdle to get over for a lot of people. And so it makes me really nervous. And not saying that's happening now, but I would love to not see that happen, make sure that happens. One of the ways that you can make sure that doesn't happen is that you support the sources in which they make it open and encourage that openness. And you can obviously subscribe directly to that publication. So if you're Wired, let's say Wired, we're not subscribed to them as a magazine, you can pay them directly. You get it in the browser, and then they have apps that you can look at it through instead of going through a single aggregation source. Or better yet, give you a better example, use your public freaking library, because with your library, you get access to both Hoopla and RB Digital, links below. And you'll be able to use your library card to check out magazines. I thought the best experience on phone, because it's the full page of the magazine. So you have to like do some pinch and zoom to be able to get in it, but you can do it in the browser too. So if you want to support free press and not have to spend any money on it and support your local library, use those apps, Hoopla and RB Digital, get a library card, log in and use those services. That way you can support them and still get access to all the news for free, the way that it should be. All right, pal. So the third topic that I want to talk about this week is continuing that discussion about exclusives, walled gardens. We were talking about with Apple, and that's what we were talking about with chat, these walled gardens where content or service or something like that exists. And it only exists in that little world. You can't get outside of it. So if you want that thing, you have to live inside of that bubble, that world. You have to obey those rules, which is a point of contention for me all the time with app stores, because they can decide what to put in their app store and what to take out at any point in time for no reason. And if Apple says no adult theme things in our store, then you can't have them, which I don't know why that's the decision Apple gets to make, but whatever. Like if I want adult stuff, what's wrong with adult things for adults? Whatever. Porn apps, cool. You want to have naked pictures on your app? Like, does it bother me any? Does it bother you? Don't, as long as they're legal. Like, go for it. So walled gardens. Let's get back on topic here. Walled gardens. What we're talking about. And what I want to talk about is gaming, because there was a lot of gaming news this week, and all of it was like red lights flashing, sirens blaring throughout all the halls of gaming, which is exclusives with Stadia and then the Epic Store and Valve announcing a new VR headset. It's just all these things point to AAA gaming studios making exclusives specifically for particular platforms. And that would be what the debate is in the gaming world, is that are exclusives to certain stores okay? And so, like, I'm working out my own opinion on this, because I'm really on the fence. And really what it comes down to is being a Linux gamer, and that, and the challenges in that. So with the Epic Store or the Microsoft Store or any of the other ones where you can buy games directly from a publisher, not available on Linux, and so I'm not really paying that close attention to them. You know, Blizzard games, like, they actively in the past have found people who are playing games in Wine and then abandoned them, and so it's just problematic when it comes to Linux gaming. So that's why I'm like really trying hard to form an opinion here about whether or not exclusives in specific stores is a problem. I mentioned last time about gaming, which is that consoles in particular have exclusives, and that's just been a thing for a long time. Game is exclusive to Xbox, game is exclusive to PlayStation, game is exclusive to Nintendo hardware, which obviously all of their core IP, like Mario and Zelda, they are all locked into the Nintendo hardware only, except for a few mobile games here and there. But otherwise, it's all locked to their particular hardware, and that's their monetization program. And that's been around for a long time, and it's been really frustrating, especially because I am not a gamer in which I'm going to own multiple consoles. In fact, I don't have any of the current-gen consoles in my house. The most current-gen console I have, that's hard for me to think about which one it might be, because it's a tie between the Wii and the Xbox 360. So the exclusive things, like, yeah, it's bugged me in the past when I had the Xbox when it was current-gen. But it's never been a real deal breaker for me. And I've been a PC gamer now for so long. Obviously, the most current console I have is Xbox 360. So I've been a PC gamer for quite some time now, and in particular, a Linux gamer. And so exclusives to particular stores on the PC doesn't bother me that much, because you can just download that store and there's a minor inconvenience. Now, the question would be, do you trust that store to be around for a long time? And what happens if that store disappears? Will they do the right thing in making it so that you can switch your games over to a better, more consistent, longer living platform like Steam, who's been around forever and is the dominant platform in all of PC gaming? Will you be able to transfer your games over to that? I'm a big fan of no DRM games, you know, because I'm a Linux hipster. So why else would I be into no DRM games? But it's really because I just avoid that. It's not reliant on a particular store. I just can download and install games, and it doesn't require a particular store to do that. I just back up the games on my file server, and then I update them every once in a while. So that's like the preferred way, but not every game is going to be that way, and obviously not AAA games are going to be that way. So is it a problem if games are exclusive to particular stores? You can install any of those stores on your Windows PC. No, I don't see that being a problem. But we take the whole PC market into consideration when it comes to OS X and Linux plus Windows, and then all these stores, almost all of them, are built specifically for Windows. Yeah, okay, I can see that being a little bit of a problem. More of a problem for OS X users, because, you know, hardware sucks and you can't do anything about it. And you have terrible GPUs integrated into your systems and you can't replace them. So I can see why gaming studios won't develop for that platform. Kind of hard to develop for, because your system, your hardware gets really old really fast. But I can also see why it's also hard for Linux, because, you know, apparently writing for distros is hard. But the I can see kind of okay across all those things that might become a problem. However, I don't see it as much of a problem because there are workarounds, there are things that you can do. So I'm still really on the fence. And I think the reason why I'm really on the fence is because Valve and Steam have been so good to me. They really are the leaders in Linux gaming, and they go out of the way to make sure that Linux games work on the platform, on the distribution, on that operating system, especially with Proton and DXVK and getting lots and lots of older Windows games to work on Linux. If I speak just for me, I have so much good faith in Steam that I'm not really, it doesn't matter if there's an exclusive on another platform because like, okay, yeah, I'd love to play Metro Exodus, but you know, they didn't make it for Linux to begin with. And the best thing for me is that it is available via Steam because Steam has put in so much work to make sure that games work on Linux. And so that's why I don't see a problem with the exclusives on particular stores because I'm really only locked to one store anyway. There's a few other stores like GOG and itch.io where they offer some indie games or maybe some older games, some good old games where they work under Linux. Sometimes it's just a wine wrapper that's on the game. And I'm not a gamer. I'm not a core gamer. I don't do I'm not in a competitive gaming or anything. So I may be the wrong person to ask about this question, but it is a big topic in the news, and I'd love to hear what your thoughts are on this and what you think about game exclusives. For me, I have an exclusive. It's Steam, because Steam is the only one that really supports Linux gaming, and so that's why I continue to stick with them. I use Lutris to install my Steam games, and then everything just works out of the box, and occasionally I buy some games from Humble or from GOG, and Lutris sets me up on all those things too, so that's really how I came. And so I don't see a problem because I don't have access to any of those other stores anyway. But I'd love to hear what you think about this and what you think about gaming and having exclusives in these stores and exclusives on consoles too, if that's really bothered you or if that's a flag that you wave to say that's why the platform that you use is better because it's an exclusive on that one. You can say, I love Xbox because they get these kinds of exclusives. I love PlayStation because they get these kinds of exclusives. So I'd love to hear from you. Tweet at me, at Dom Corvo. Leave a comment below. Let me know what you think about game exclusives. Like I said, I'm really on the fence about it, so kind of help me figure out which side of the fence I'm supposed to be on for this. Otherwise, I'm just going to continue to love Steam because I have no reason to not love them. Proton and DXVK work perfectly, and I've been playing lots of games that previously didn't work on Linux now work phenomenally on my aging gaming PC. All right, pals, it's the last time we're going to talk for this week, and I want to start off something, a new trend that I want to start with this podcast and something that we are going to do every week from now on. And talked about a lot of things this week. I've done lots of ranting about things this week. And so what I want to end with is let's do something cool. So every Thursday, because this podcast is Monday through Thursday, I want to end the week with, let's do a project together. Let's just do a project. I'm going to work on it over the weekend. You work on it over the weekend. Let's set some stuff up. Let's talk about it. Let's just do something cool. And sometimes that's going to be setting up a system. Maybe sometimes that's just going out and doing a thing, going to an event, going to like a Linux user group or something like that. Maybe it's just getting things organized. I don't know. Like for me, an example of that for me would be every year I print about 200 pictures from our previous year because I want to have a hard copy of all of our best pictures in the house, and we put it into a photo album. I have years worth of these photo albums on the bookshelf. That's the type of project that we can do over the weekend. Tech-related, backups, obviously, going through photos, doing photo editing, all that stuff kind of tech-related, maybe learn something new. That's what I want to do every Thursday. Let's try and do something new. Let's take a chance. Let's learn something and maybe even set up a new service or, you know, just get a chance to play with something. I find myself every week kind of thinking about, not necessarily bored, but just like, I want to play. I want to have a playground. I want to just do some random stuff that's tech related. So every Thursday, I want to just throw out an idea. Let's have some fun over the weekend. I'd love to hear ideas from you too. So get me on Twitter at Dom Corvo or leave a comment if there's a project you'd like to see done. And then I'm going to do it over the weekend. I'm going to tweet about it. So follow me on Twitter at Dom Corvo and you'll be able to see my progress as it goes throughout the weekend about setting something up that we talked about on Thursday. And then if we're stuck, if one of us is stuck as we're going through it, we'll be able to talk to each other and see how we can set that up or make that happen. Maybe it's just like, hey, let's do some co-op game with someone over the weekend. That would be something fun that we can do over the weekend. Maybe us as a group can find each other and we'll be able to do some gaming. This week, what I want to do for the weekend project is setting up a music streaming server. As of this week, I have had enough of Spotify. And to be totally honest with you, all my music problems all go back to one thing, and that's the death of RDO. How I missed RDO was the perfect music system, music streaming service for me. And I wish I could go back to RDO. Alas, here we are, no RDO. All we have is the terrible, terrible streaming options that we have now, which are all solely based on you finding new music. Now, I thought this was a ranty week. It's time for old man Dominic to do some ranting. So hold on to your seatbelts here.
Who are you, old man?
Name's Old Man Waterfall, but most folks just call me Old Man.
Yes, these platforms, these services, these subscription services are fantastic for finding new music. Do I want to do that every fucking time I turn on a streaming service? No fucking way. That is the answer to that question. I'm an old man, and you know what old men like? The same shit again and again and again. And if you're a man over 30, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Once you hit 30, you realize that all the best music was made somewhere between the age of when you were the age of 16 to 24. All of a sudden, Western movies start to make sense, and doing things like mowing the lawn become exciting things to do on the weekends. So old men, you are with me on this, and old people in general, you probably are. I don't know. I can't speak for women. I can definitely speak for men. Once we hit a certain age, doing the same thing all the time, quite all right in our book. And so when I turn on this streaming service and I start, you know, music from the greatest era of music, 1996 to 2004, why would I get music from outside of any other generation? Great hip hop and rap transition to great alternative and heavy metal. Why would I listen to any other music? Why would I not listen to Tupac, Rage Against the Machine, and the Lamb of God? Why would I not? I don't understand why I want new music. But if you turn on one of those things, you listen to three songs, and what do you get after that? Start getting new music. I don't care about new music. I'm an old man, Spotify. All I want to listen to is the same shit I've listened to for the last 20 years. I don't need any new music in my life. I can't fathom. I can't learn new artist names and things like that. I can't learn. We're in an era without albums. Old man Dominic cannot comprehend an era in which albums don't matter anymore, that you just listen to individual songs. I grew up in an era when radio, I was recording songs off the radio. Then by the time I graduated from high school, downloading MP3s from Napster was a thing. So music changed quite a bit as I went through my teenage years. I'm not ready to learn more systems and ways to listen to music. Just give me the music that I love and don't give me any of this new stuff. Told you, I'm an old man now. I can't handle new music. Don't give it to me. So I've had it up to here with the new music. I just want to listen to my own stuff and make my own playlist and play them in that exact order. And I'm sure when I said to my wife, that's it, I've had enough this weekend. My weekend project is going to be to set up my own music streaming service. She could say, oh, thank God, because I'm tired of listening to him complain about how terrible Spotify is and about how much he's tired of listening to new music. And he just wants to listen to the same stuff again and again and again. I can't help it if Too Short's 10th album was the greatest rap album that ever existed, Melissa. There's nothing I can do about that. It's just the way that it is. I want to listen to Getting It. I don't want to listen to a new rap song. I don't care about any of that stuff. Is it Getting It? I'm not interested then. So let's set up our own music streaming service this weekend. There's lots of options out there, including Ampachi, Subsonic, Plex does this mostly. And I say mostly because I have Plex running on a FreeNAS system. And the radio feature on Plex for music doesn't work under BSD. I don't know why that is. So maybe time for a new Linux server on that. I don't know. Let's do some experimentation this weekend. Weekend project this weekend, setting up your own music streaming service. Here's the rules. Self-hosted, not register for some other music system. Yeah, okay, that's not necessarily a tech thing to do. It's just give someone your credit card. So it has to be self-hosted. Can be a VPS off in the cloud or on your local machine. If you want to listen to it off your local network or on just on your local network, that's fine. But it needs to have a mobile app. self-host plus mobile app, not just listen to on the desktop. You can't, not just like a file server with settings share turned on and then a music player that is just using your file share as its source for all of the music. No, I want it to be like for real streaming service. So then you use a mobile app to be able to do that. So I want to see what it is that you have and what you set up. Let's talk about it throughout the weekend. That is the weekend project. So that is going to do it for me this week. I really appreciate you hanging out with me this week. I had a lot of fun talking about these topics. I can't wait to see the streaming services that are going to be set up and be sharing what I'm working on. I decided which route that I'm going to go. There's lots of options and lots of them I've set up before, but haven't gotten any traction. So maybe another step in that is has to be approval by other people. Let's just keep it to us. Let's just keep it to the people who care. Who care about when good music was made. They only want to listen to the good music. Let's set up these streaming services. Let's give it a try this weekend. Let's learn, try and learn some new things. And I'm looking forward to seeing those things on Twitter. Tweet at me, at Dom Corvo. Leave comments in the notes below. You can find links to everything that I talked about today and all the things I talked about this week in the notes and also on the website, obscurednarration.com. I haven't mentioned that website all week this week. So be sure to go check out obscurednarration.com and you can see the also sporadic blog posts that I post and then also all the links to all of the episodes. That is going to do it for me this week. I hope you enjoyed all these episodes. I loved hanging out with you and we'll see y'all next time.